Well, I'm going to tell you a little about Kaya de Wijk. We're a small cable operator in the Netherlands. 20,000 homes passed, and we made some unique choices in the past. And I'm going to take you along this a bit technical, a bit strategical. So we're a non-for-profit organization, and we are still here since 75. This is the Netherlands. That's Harderwijk, just in the middle. We're the fifth biggest cable company of the Netherlands, but that's not because we're so big, but because there's one big Ziggo, Liberty Global, in the Netherlands. So when you look at our infrastructure, well, it's coax from the start, 1975. In 1998, we started with the cable modem technology network, COM21. In 2010, we introduced DOCSIS 3.0. We did 100 megabit symmetrical, and we opened up the network. In 2012, fiber to the home, and this year we are deploying fiber to the home up to the last homes, the rural area. So why deploy fiber to the home? Well, do consumers want fiber? Well, that's what you would think. When you look at all the advertisements, you think that's what they want. And if they don't get it, they get angry. So they probably want fiber. But is that the truth? Is it fiber we want, or is it just a service? If you have a house, you put fiber in the house, and you deliver a service, telephony, internet, television, it's a good price, people are happy. But if it would be coax in the home, and we would deliver telephony, television, internet, a good price, people would be happy. In fact, if we would put barbed wire in the house and we would deliver the services, people would be happy. So it's about services. And still we deploy fiber. So why did we? Our message to the consumer was, we are deploying fiber, but nothing's going to change. And we did not see a killer application. But we were expecting much more traffic on the network. Video is emerging from linear to non-linear, so the load on the network is just adding up and adding up, and we've seen it today many times in the presentations. So there's a huge impact on the cable network, and especially on a typical star topology network. If you look at the normal network, and this is a bit of a black white situation, but it's to explain, if everybody's watching the same channel in a network and it's just a broadcast situation, then it's all 5 megabits also up in the network. It doesn't add up. If they are watching Netflix and they are all watching 5 megabits channels, then it does add up. And it adds up each point in the star topology network. So there's much more data going through the network. So we need more capacity in the network. So how should we get it? Well, we considered a few technologies. We considered Ethernet to the home. I must say it was 2009, 10 years ago. So the technology at that time, we looked at Ethernet to the home, we looked at DOCSIS and fiberizing in steps. And we wanted a fiber-like product in the home. So we were looking for symmetrical services in the home. That's why we first looked at Ethernet to the home, because they, at that moment, they offered a service, and we could implement it in the network. This is the network, well, which it normally looks like. There's an upstream, there's the downstream, and in the Netherlands, there are not that much trunk situations. Mostly, it's a node, group amplifier, and amplifier. And we could implement Ethernet to the home in the part from 0 to 35 megahertz. And there would be 100 megabit Ethernet shared in that part of the network. And we could use the part from the node to the group amplifier with also 100 megabit Ethernet of virtual fiber at that moment. Technically, this would be a good solution, which we could grow in and also fiberize in steps, because we could get the 100 megabit at the end amplifier, we could get fiber to the group amplifier if there would be more need for data throughput. So that would be a step. And in the end, we could say, well, build a fiber to the home network over it, and you could get the POPs down into the network, and you could say, let's just add fiber to the group amplifier and just build up in steps. The good thing about this would be investments would follow the demand, but it would not be the most efficient fiber to the home network in our mind, because there would be an inefficiency if you migrate the cable to fiber to the home this way. If you start a fiber to the home network from scratch, there would be a POP location for 2,500 households. There would be a distribution point for 48 households. But if we would fiberize the end amplifiers and the multi-taps, then it would not be this way. So you would not be very efficient in your fiber to the home network. So we considered DOCSIS 3.0. Again, it was 2009. High data throughput, it would be simple to deploy because there was a return path, so we could just put it in the network. We could deploy it where there was the demand, you know, in the home. It's well supported, it's DOCSIS, proven technology, and DOCSIS prices were still going down. So when we look at investing in a future-proof network, what would we do? Now, fiber to the home, it's definitely future-proof, but it's a real high investment. Ethernet to the home, it looked like a good technique, but we also knew it would not be the end point. And we had to do a full migration at once, so would it be smart to do that? And then there was DOCSIS 3.0, which would be very scalable, and it could be a good intermediate step to fiber to the home. So what we did, we said this would be our route forward. We are going to roll out DOCSIS 3.0, and there would be broadband through the entire network from the start, and we are going to deploy fiber to the home in phases. And this would mean that we would get a part from Harderwijk and put in a POP, deploy fiber to the home, DOCSIS capacity would free up there, and we could put that in the other part where there's still DOCSIS. So we could go on in steps. This is what we used. It was fully equipped, 12 segments, 400 megabit throughput per segment, 64 downstreams, it were only 20,000 households, 108 megabits throughput upstream, and we did something different. We had the channel bonding and we offered 100 megabits symmetrical in the network. Now, this was very special, of course, because that was not done before. Got a lot of attention in the media, trending topic. ISP reviews that we rarely cover non-UK news. This one deserves a mention. It was more a PR thing. We had 10, 20, 40 megabits and 100 megabits symmetrical was just also an offering. There was 0.3% who used it, but there were neighboring communities with fiber and they also had 100 megabits symmetrical and we also had it. So for us, it was a good thing. In 2012, we rolled out fiber to the home, point-to-point network. I know that in Netherlands, that's one of the there are many places where it's GPON. In the Netherlands, it's almost everywhere still point-to-point. That's also what we did because we wanted to have other parties on the network. So we said we have to build it the way they want to use it. We use a Cisco 9000. In the city POP and Cisco 4500 in the POPs, and they are all connected with an uplink 2 × 10 gigabit, so enough capacity for a time. This is the city of Harderwijk. 2010, we had DOCSIS in what is green, that's where the coax is, and we could deliver the 100 megabits symmetrical. In 2014, the fiber to the home was deployed, also in some places where there was not coax yet, but we could deliver the gigabit in this area. And 2019, there will be 100% gigabit through the whole community. But we made another far-reaching choice. As a small cable operator, we opened up the network by structural separation. And our aim was one infrastructure for all. So the idea is, if you want to have 50 people move from A to B, you get a bus and you put 50 people in it. If you want to move 50 people from A to B, you don't get two buses and let two buses drive from A to B. If you have 10,000 people, you build a city for 10,000 people. You don't build two cities for 10,000 people. If you have a city of 10,000 homes, you build one infrastructure for 10,000 homes. You don't build two infrastructures for 10,000. So when you look at infrastructure and where we come from, once it was simple, there was cable and there was the DSL telco cable in the home. One delivered telephony and the other delivered television. Two lines, two services. Then internet came into our homes. All services on both networks. Something else changed here because a choice on infrastructure came along. You could say, deliver all services and do it on this one infrastructure. Now, this choice is not only in those two homes. This choice is through an entire network. So there are now two infrastructures in the city, and they are both half empty, or half full, if you're positive. If you look at this in like the network itself, this is, again, the early days. There were two infrastructures, and both were fully used. So services are on both networks. They're covered by both networks. Costs are of the both networks in every home. And everybody's paying for it. Now, I just showed something changed in this network. They are delivering all services. Something else changed to fixed networks, only one market. So they're half empty. The costs are still the same in the network, but they're covered by only half of the people who are using it. If we look at this at the connection level, this is again the situation in the, from the start. 95% is using it, and there's profit from the one service on the network. But it got half empty. So when you look at the costs from at this one connection, he has to pay twice as much because the other half is not paying for it anymore. And the services are going down by half. We don't mind, because there are other services which are paying. This is the situation at the moment. But what it also means, new services have compensated the network inefficiency on the network. I'll explain that, because as a result, competitive services have now become a threat. The threat of OTT at a low occupancy rate. Skype, WhatsApp, fiber, there are several other ways to make your phone call. This also means you don't need the service from the provider anymore. And you can't sell it anymore. And as if it's not enough, you can also buy your video another way. So you don't need that anymore. Now, if the network would be full, the cost of the network would go through half because there would be twice as much people paying for it. So services are under threat. The ARPU is under pressure. One market, two infrastructures. And those ARPUs are chained to those infrastructures. Now what if we would have structural separation? One infrastructure is then possible because the service is somebody else's and it's your own mind how to build the infrastructure. Well, let's build one infrastructure. And the services can all be on one network. Now this makes more sense because there's just one network which is fully used. and all the services can use the network. So that became our spot on the horizon. Services from others should lead to network usage in the network of Kaardenwijk, and we only deliver tracks. And we are going to leave service delivery to the market, which is also good because we are just a small party in the Netherlands, so services are a big thing for us, and others can do it better. Our goals: maximize free choice and availability of services. Every service provider should be able to deliver its own services, and every customer should be able to make its own choices. And in the end, we should reach the highest possible occupancy rate on the network. So, open up the network and retreat as a service provider, separate network and services. Now, this is the situation in Harderwijk. There's the layer one, which is the passives. There's the layer two, which is the equipment, and the layer three, which are the services. Now, this is the situation almost everywhere. In Harderwijk, there are service providers which are using the layer two of Kaardenwijk, and there are service providers which are using the layer one of Kaardenwijk. The bigger service providers, they want to invest, so they buy their own equipment and they use the passive network. And the smaller service providers, they don't want to invest, and we create a low barrier because we say, well, we invest for you and you just connect to the equipment. On layer two, the investments for us are on a customer demand, so we only invest where it's needed, but it's a low investment barrier for the smaller ISPs. Sorry, on the layer two and on layer one, there's an investment in all the houses because we already did built the network. It's a low process barrier for the bigger ISPs. And in the end, that's what it's all about. We maximize usage of the passive infrastructure, which was already built and already paid for. And what we reached in the end is a level playing field with total neutrality of Kaardenwijk, because for us, it doesn't matter who is delivering the services, it's always network usage. And it's not even for the ISPs, but it's also for the over the top. I mean, if they want to go to Netflix, well, go to Netflix, they still use the network. So what we reach: effective market competition for all services through ISP and also over the top. So what goals did we achieve with this as a small cable operator? Well, high-speed symmetrical broadband. These were the goals for 2020. 100% should have 30 megabits and 50% should have 100 megabits. They were now for 2025. Everybody should have 100 megabit and they should have a possibility to go to 1 gigabit. Well, what did we reach in 2015? 90.6 got 100 megabit and 96.6 got a gigabit. And our news for this year, of course, end of the year, everybody will have 1 gigabit in the community. There's a very high occupancy rate on the fiber to the home network. It's now 76%, which is extremely high. And which is also not strange, because the cable, which were we, and the DSL party KPN is also renting access on our network. So they are now delivering services to customers over the fiber to the home network. So it doesn't matter who is delivering the services, they are always using this network. And it's only the customers which are still left on DSL, which are not on the fiber to the home network. And there's a free and wide choice on the network. These are the providers which are now available on the network. Well, this is always a funny thing to mention. The Dutch Consumers Union criticized lack of choice in broadband in the Netherlands. They said, if you want to have high broadband choice, then the higher bandwidth you want, the less choice you have. But there was one exception: Internet Walhalla Harderwijk. That's what we are in the Netherlands. And of course, cherry on the cake, European Broadband Award in 2015 for openness and competition, which was always also very nice. So what about cord cutting, which is of course something you hear about. People are getting rid of their cable television subscription. Well, we anticipate it. We deliver lines, not services. Services by others result in these lines in our network. So for us, this was a good milestone. This was 2016, and we had more fiber to the home clients on the network than coax connections, because our coax connections are still degrading, but we are getting more clients on the fiber to the home network. So, only opportunities, no threats. Well, there is one for us, and that's net neutrality, which is a big thing. I mean, it's something you hear more and more about, and there are services available which are not really neutral, net neutral, and this is also a threat for our model, and I can explain this, because if you look at our model and you would have like Netflix, they can make arrangements with one of the bigger ISPs in the network and make sure that their service gets in the home better or gets in the home. Other services wouldn't be able to make this arrangement and they would not be available or maybe not as good available. But it also means the smaller ISPs can maybe not make those arrangements and cannot deliver the service as good as the other ones. So for us, this means net neutrality is also very important, because if you want a level playing field, then also internet access should be open. But still, we reached European goals by far. It's an open network. It's a level playing field on the network. And we are on a steady way of realizing 80 to 90% occupation degree. And yes, it's an infrastructure monopoly, but we're not shareholder driven and working from a social objective. So we think it's still a good thing for the end customer in our community. And that ends my story.
Well, that was fascinating. Are there any questions? Yes.
Who is responsible ultimately for network security if you're just handling the physical layer?
The service provider in the end. For us, it's layer two. So we don't do public IPs, just layer two access, VLANs.
Other questions? There's at least two over there.
I think we're going to get you earning your fascinating team. Stuff, Ed. I applaud the effort, I really do. Do you find you have to construct different SLAs with the different end users of the network to guarantee performance, and how do you juggle that?
That's an important thing for us, because we are in between. So we feel we have to work harder to assure everything is working. If it's a vertical and the service is not working, it's your network which has a problem. And in our situation, if the service is not working, then they will come to us and say, it's not working, so you've got a problem. For us, that's also has been a reason why fiber to the home was easier for us, because it's easier to guarantee data throughput, and in the coaxial network it's shared, and if there are more providers, then they will say, well, it's because of him that it's not working with me. But that's true, and an important role for us is to be the oil in everything, and we see that as an important thing, yes.
Could you pass the microphone sideways, please? Thank you.
So I wondered what your thoughts were about the model and whether that model would be successful if you were in a, let's say, a competitive environment with a profit motive.
I think it would be also very successful, but a commercial monopoly is probably not that good for the market. So I think that's why it's good that we are what we are. But in the end, we are the only way to the customer. So if you look at it from a commercial perspective, we could ask high prices and make a lot of money.
Yeah. Any other questions? Another one up here.
Thank you. Just to follow on. So how did you finance it, given your not profit making? Was it sort of you spread it over 10 years and you saved up money each way? Or
yeah, that's a good question, because people always think, well, if you're non-profit, then there, you can't earn money or there is no money left. But we have to plan in advance, and we reserve the money. Is that the way you say it in English? So we make sure that we can do our investments in the future. It's in our planning. Yeah.
Right, another question next door, yeah.
I just had a question. Did you get any pushback from, is KPN run the DSL network? Did they, because obviously they're putting investment into their own DSL network and this completely makes it obsolete. So was there anything on that front?
It's Harderwijk is the, at this moment, the only place where they are using a third-party network. So they call it a pilot. But they are using it very well, and there are now new built areas in the Harderwijk where there's just one infrastructure, just one fiber, our fiber. There's no coax and there's no DSL, there's no copper. No.
Okay, any more questions? No, it remains for me to thank you for sharing your experiences.
Very welcome.
Thank you, Eden.